And we have the co-teachers with us. Good evening. Yes, I'm fine. Neelu, Rohit, Mauni, Iffat, Zehra. By the way, all the teachers, I request if you open up the our YouTube channel. Maybe if Dimple Madam, if you have the channel, you can share with all of them. Okay, I'll put it for their convenience. Otherwise, I'm seeing the comments. So yes, well, good evening, Saimul. Good evening, Aman, Sai, Dhanishta. So fine, otherwise, doesn't matter. I'll be informing you. I will be telling you about whatever questions which are coming up. So welcome all of you. We had one webinar couple of weeks ago where we discussed the entire strategy for preparation for the GS. And with us, we had rank 12, Ajay, and we also had a senior IAS officer, Sonalika Jivani. And they had guided you about how to prepare for GS, about notes making, about managing the time aspects, how to manage the books and the current affairs newspaper. But today's webinar is a bit different. It's more of get familiar with the Edukemi team. So you can see with us, we have Mr. Shivesh Kumar. Shivesh sir will take up history. We have Ms. Deepika Kanwar. She will take up geography. And she also will assist us and be your tutor, educator for environment topics. We have Ms. Dimple. Dimple Madam will be helping us in a lot of coordination work. Along with, she'll be taking up topics related to ethics, some topics related to environment. And we have Ranu Madam, Ms. Ranu Singh. She will be the economy teacher. Madam, your mic is switched off. So is Ashwini Shankar sir's mic, but that's okay. We'll have questions we can discuss thereafter. Good evening, Ashok, Ishan. Can you all confirm if you can see all of us on the Zoom? Can you see the team right now?
So only you are visible.
Okay, okay. I think we are missing something. Just give me. Just give me a second. Let me set this. Let me set this.
Right
now.
So only
your
visible.
Okay. Oh, we have. Just a minute. Just a minute, please. Let me set it right. 1 minute. Just let me set this right. Dimple ma'am, can you say something? Let me check. If the screen captures that,
sir,
you can address the students. We cannot hear your voice.
Sir, I was visible when I speak. So
no, your voice is not. Yeah, please continue.
Sir, I was visible when I was speaking. So the one who would speak would be visible.
Yeah, it's fine now. Okay, so as we speak, we are audible. Yes. Okay, that makes sense. Okay, that makes sense. Fine then. I think we can take off. Yes. The system works as in whenever some of us speaks, it's audible. So okay. So we have all the team members here. Right. Okay. Thank you so much. So, introducing the team to all of you, we will see them one by one. Now the agenda that we are taking up to start with is, what are the main issues that students are concerned about when we start off the GS preparation? There are concerns related to what books to read. There are concerns related to what type of notes making we should have. There are concerns related to time management. There are concerns related to concepts. So I will be asking the faculty from Edukemi to tell us one by one what they think should be the best way to manage some of these things. Like, for example, Shivesh sir, can you please tell us how students should be making notes when they start preparation? What type of note making would you suggest so that they are not able to miss out on what they study and what they revise at the last minute?
Of course, notes actually is the vital part of their preparation. And all the religious texts that they had in mind, it is there in the notes itself. So normally students go through three ways of making the notes. First, they cover the exhaustive syllabus or exhaustive topic that is going to be covered in the class itself. Second, they try to point out some, jotting down some points and making the elaboration themselves. And third, they summarize the entire class notes in single page. And all the three parts are relevant for their study. And one more way is that they can go for that while making notes, they should have a plenty of space on their notebook so that if they study any reference book.
Is the audio fine to all of you who are attending this webinar?
Yes, sir.
Is the audio fine?
Yes, sir, it is coming, sir. It is loud and clear, sir.
Ishan, Shukla, can you tell us if the audio is fine? Sneha, are you all able to listen to what we are saying?
Yes, sir, they are.
Yes. And did you also capture the audio of Shivesh, sir?
It's picture is
also. So we can continue then.
Okay, sir, fine. So what actually last point I was talking about, that while making notes in class, students should have a plenty of spaces there left. They should not write in a very watertight wording. So if they will study other reference book in future, they will point out some of the facts there and then and there only. So that in the end of the day, they had only one book to prepare and only one note to prepare. So there were plenty of the books scattered around while the final revision time is there. That should be avoided. Otherwise, it would create confusion. So better to have a single note that includes the class notes also. And at the same time, whatever they study about the reference book also, some of the important points should be noted down there then and there only. If they would revise one notebook, that would be enough for the last moment preparation, I think.
Right, sir. We got the idea there. So if we are having students, the challenge with the student is that they're not able to balance off the notes making along with answer writing. So Dimple ma'am, what do you think? At what stage should students start off answer writing practice? What will be the right time to start off answer writing?
Sir, answer writing not only requires conceptual clarity, but also having control over the time and the amounts of words that are needed. What happens, many times students start answer writing from day one, and because they do not have sufficient content to write the answers, they end up being frustrated because they tend to write within the time constraint. So one should avoid that. Once the basic is clear, the basic can after 2 or 3 months of the preparation, once they have a fair idea, then they can initiate themselves, the student can initiate themselves into the answer writing. They should not start answer writing right from the day one. Have a sufficient conceptual clarity, the base, revision, and then that should be followed by answer writing.
Right. That makes sense. So essentially, until the basics are clear, and this is something for all of you to remember, that if you start off answer writing right from day one, it becomes a problem. So thank you there. Now, I think one of the concerns students, one of the problems students face is many of the students are directly from the colleges, fresh from their graduation. So when they jump from graduation to the kind of range of topics GS tries to cover, there are a lot of problems in managing the concepts. I think this is one problem that students of economy have. So if I ask Miss Madam Ranu Singh, how do you think students can take care of the range of concepts that they are trying to get into? Can you tell us, Madam, something on that, please?
For economy, first thing, they should start from the NCERT. After reading NCERT, they'll be knowing the concepts and they'll understand the subject. Because in economics, the major problem students face is understanding the words and then relating it to the current affairs. So for economics, the best thing is to start from class 9th NCERT and then gradually 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th. So they will have the conceptual clarity. They will know the word. Then they can appreciate the events they will read.
So you think this should be the strategy even otherwise for all the subjects? Okay, yeah, that's one suggestion is students can take up the keywords and maybe keep a bank of that. So should you be doing this for all type of subjects? Say if I ask Ashwini sir, what about sociology, social issues and issues of society? Do we have technical words that students should keep track of when they start off preparation?
Yes, sir. It matters a lot, actually, because you see, everybody says you study, you work hard, but how to study, how to go, that makes a very big difference. And when you are studying, you need to understand the kind of language, because every subject, every topic has its own vocabulary. When I'm talking about social issues, if you don't write diversity, if you don't mention like manner of reconciliation, so these are the words that makes an impression on the mind of the examiner. Therefore, it becomes imperative we need to build up our language according to the subject also. Number one. Number two, when you are approaching like topic like social issues, why this topic is given in the UPSC examination? What they want to basically examine? They want to examine your social sensibility towards the society. Therefore, whenever you're reading newspapers, you're reading magazines, you have to become aware of this topic.
Right. Right. Okay. So more or less, we understand that notes making is a very important part of the process of preparation. Students should not get into answer writing directly. Okay, make your running notes good. Make sure you have got summaries of your class notes and make sure that you also are handling the concepts very well. Now, time management is a tricky aspect. So if I ask Deepshika madam, what type of time management you think students can manage because they are already into preparation for the GS, for the optional. So how can we balance a day's work? Can you give us a short idea on that, madam, please?
Yes, sir. As you mentioned that students will already be doing a lot of classes. So first thing they should do is that whatever they are doing, they should be good at it. Fine. So if you're taking any class, you should at least allocate around half of the time that you have devoted in the class for making the notes. Fine, after the class. So that is very important because if you are taking the classes and you are not revising or jotting down or making the important notes, then there is no relevance of what you are reading. So if you're just focused on, okay, one class, two class, and now you're reading some other material from any other book. So that is not something that will work here. First of all, you have to build the basics. And for that, whatever has been taught in the class, you should first make proper summary of all those notes. Then you can go to the reference books if there is any mentioned in the class and you can jot down all the points in your notes. So this is how you be very much sure that what is the outcome you are getting from the class itself. Okay, the next thing is newspaper. The newspaper is, first of all, you are building the basics. Now, sometimes what happens is that you won't be able to understand the newspaper very well. Because again, the terms used like inflation for economy, things used in terms of agriculture, things that you may not know now. So these are the things that you have to understand to leave. For now, then when you build the basics, when you have a hold on the concepts, then you can go on and read magazines and whatever you can decide to read. So first of all, the clarity is what should be read. why it should be read, because it is part of the syllabus. So first go through the syllabus, and the last thing is when to read what. So you should start with the NCERT's basics, complete the concepts, and then go for higher level studies. So that is how you have to build the strategy for this examination.
Right. So more or less, you know, time management, if I conclude, will be more about learning the process slowly and gradually. There is no one formula for time management. What we all are trying to tell you, and so did Madam, was learn to prioritize what is more important. And when you join a course, when you join classroom sessions, and particularly when you're juggling with GS and optional, it's very important that you primarily pay attention to the classes, pay attention to the class content, the class lecture, the class notes, and the reference readings given to you by the class itself, rather than spreading yourself thin across lot of courses and lot of books to read at the same time. Now, one question, if I may ask the entire team, maybe Shivesh sir can also answer. I'll take up specific subjects one by one. What can be the approach? I think history is quite a big chunk of your GS preparation. We have got history related to modern India. We have history of ancient India, medieval India. We also have history topics related to world history. So sir, what is the right approach to study history? How can students approach history in a more convenient way, in a more familiar way, so that they are able to do justice to the subject? Can you tell us, please, sir?
Yes, sir. See, history is actually referred as the very bulky subject normally among the students. But what I feel, the length of the syllabus is more than what actually we see the content, because they have divided many subdivisions with the history within the topic itself. But what is the right approach to understand history? First, you have the bird's eye view of the entire century or a decade, so that thereafter you can fill the gap with the events. And thereafter, chronologically, you can be very sound and very accurate. If you try to understand the chronology first and try to build the decade or the century, that will be a very difficult task. Means we have to go through upside down. First, you understand the bird's eye view of the entire century, and then try to put the certain chronology in between. And thereafter, you will become having the mastering over the events. And there is no need to remember the dates thereafter, because simply by understanding the chronology of the events or the story, you can find out the year also or dates also. So specifically, UPSC never ask any year or the date, but they definitely ask the chronology. So this is the way that we can start here with. In last prelims question paper, you can see there were 20 questions from the history. And out of that 20, 10 from directly from the modern India. So you have to prioritize yourself that in which segment you are going to focus. The modern India is always being hunting ground in both mains and prelims as well. And formula is very straight, that it is better to read one book 10 times instead of reading 10 books single times. This is the best formula that students should get. Normally, a student used to tell us that, sir, we have completed this book. It's never been completed. Actually, whenever we try to revise it many times, every time you will get something new in between the lines. And that in between the lines actually reflect in examination. So I will advise the students that read as many times as you can go of single book instead of reading so many junk of the books in your library. So this is the approach that we have to follow.
Sir, there are two questions that are coming up from the students.
Yes.
One question is, should they give disproportionately more time for ancient India? Because this year, I think there are more questions on ancient India. And second, one of them are asking that the questions in history are increasingly more conceptual based in at least the mains examination.
No, sir.
So what is the answer on these two questions, sir? We have a question from Sandhya, and we have one question from Yogesh.
I have
and what about medieval history? Pooja Parihar is asking us, can we skip medieval history or not?
No, definitely there is nothing to skip in history, because history is continuity and change. There is no topic, there is no period in the history. So there is, we can't skip anything in history. We have breakup of the question asked this year. Modern India, we have 10 questions. Ancient India, we have 2 questions. Medieval India, we have 3 questions. And art and culture, we have 5 questions. So that 3 questions, those who are asking medieval India to skip, you can't skip. There is no second chance. And therefore, we have to give equal weightage. Means 10 questions from modern India and 10 questions from other segments, ancient, medieval, and culture. So there's no point of disproportionating the timing for your study period. There should be equal balance. All the 5 fingers are equal that you have to put the footing. And one more question that students had asked. I think it was related to preparation model. What actually one student had asked? That was second question.
Second question was, sir, one more question, that is, should they focus on, there are many questions which were asked from Shekhar Bandyopadhyay. So should they focus on this particular book at the initial stage itself?
Okay, for modern India, we have 2 very prominent book to refer. One was, that is the India Struggle for Independence led by Bipin Chandra and company. And second is, that is the Policy to Partition by Shekhar Bandyopadhyay. What actually I found, I told you that it is better to read one book 10 times. But when you go through modern India, it is always advisable to read one supplementary also. Shekhar Bandyopadhyay is very important for mains examination point of view. What I realized, their comments, their conclusion, or the some statements directly come in the main examination. But as far as prelims come, mains is concerned, the Bipin Chandra's book is very important. So therefore, we have to go both.
Okay. So more or less, I think students have to understand that history is not a mechanical subject.
Yes,
I think that is one problem students have. They assume history is a mechanical subject and that they have to keep on mugging of facts. It is not like that, I believe. If that is what you want to stress,
yes.
And students, if I tell you about the approaches, absolutely. Rahul Singh is asking us what can be the approach for art and culture. I think it's a question that troubles everyone. Art and culture is a huge portion of history, at least to be prepared and revised, even if questions not enough. So what can we do for art and culture, sir?
Fine, sir. Let me respond. Actually, India is a multiracial, multicultural, multilingual, multireligious. There are so many multis in this multi. So we can say Indian society is a polyglot society. So understanding art and culture of this diverse land, I want to convey to the student, those who ask this question. First, you understand India. India is more like a civilization rather than nation. We are basically a citizen of a civilization rather than
citizen. We have a question from Mahir, from Priyadarshini. She's asking us, how is spectrum? I think spectrum for history has been a book for a long time. Though personally, I think it is not the right book for the type of questions asked today now, last 4-5 years. But I'll ask sir to answer what he thinks about that.
Since day one, in last 15 years, what actually I'm counting, I'm like approaching this book day by day, because it creates so much of the junk of the facts in the minds of the student. But after reading 2-3 pages, they didn't give up. They never complete the book. I understand. Reason is that.
Right. I think Shivesh sir's
there's nothing
connectivity. Let me introduce Sunil Gupta sir. He has joined us just a few minutes ago. He is one of the very senior faculties in our team. Thank you for joining us. Sir will be taking topics related to polity and governance. He's also been the teacher for public administration and also portions of ethics. Right now, he will be talking mostly about polity and governance. Sir, we have started the discussion in your absence while you still joined us. Sir, what do you think? What should be the approach for studying polity? what type of books can be studied and what type of references can be looked up.
First of all, I would like to say sorry and good evening to you all. So for the polity and governance, what I feel, according to the experience and according to the experiment with the students, three-pronged strategies are going to work. The first is the conceptualization. Concepts should be very clear. And second important, what is called the information enrichment. In polity, information may be classified into two parts. One is called traditional information, another is called the contemporary information. Traditional information has to give you the base. Contemporary information just enrich your base. Then third important, what is called writing practice. These three things, if you have, you are going to get very good score in polity and governance. So first important, conceptualization. Conceptualization basically classified into three parts. The first is called the Constitution of India. Constitution has to give the goal of the state, goal of the nation. Nation ko kaise chalana hai, the goal of nation is coming from the Constitution of India. Second is the structure. A structure that has to manage the goal. The structure again be divided into three parts, executive, legislature, and the judiciary. And third important part, what is called the processing. Because if a structure is going to work for the national development, then processings are being done. These processing areas are called the governance. So three important part of conceptualization, if you are going to do, then you can do each and everything very comfortably. This is the first important conceptualization. Second is the information. Friends, information enrichment should be there, not information enlargement. Information enrichment means information should be collected by authentic sources. And many panelists told you that information is concerned. Information should be collected from the basic sources, standard sources. For the polity and governance information, you can collect from Lakshmikanthji books are concerned
in polity. Right.
And second, D.D. Basu, that is the very standard book. And third book that is related to India, our parliament by the Subhash Kashyap. These three books are traditionally, I think, you know, that is very sufficient for you. But apart from that, you have to add contemporary information from the newspaper, from the All India Radio, some new
and sir, if I ask you, I'm sorry to interject here, a couple of questions coming up. If I ask you, sir, what should be the reference books for polity? And so that the burden of reading too much, because Lakshmikanth is quite a big book. Mm-hmm. Would you recommend that, or there are some other shorter ways? Though I'm not a very big fan of shortcuts, but what do you think, sir?
Yeah, actually, sir, information is concerned. The information is a part of the compilation. Then Lakshmikanth books, all the topics are not so important. One is certain topics and certain materials are important. Then aspirant has to make the selection of the material according to the competitiveness. So if they are in class, they are in the very great coachings, then the student can get the help from the different coach that where the information you can gather. Although conceptualization is also possible through the NCRT, and the NCRT, they have to go through that, and basic information is given under the NCRT. Then and thereafter, you know, Lakshmikanth has become very, you know, easy book, very light book here, and you can compile the information. Apart from that, D.D. Basu and Subhash Kashyap books, that is more than sufficient to compile the traditional information. Rest of contemporary information, they have to add from the different sources. That may include newspaper, that may include analysis, that may include, you know, internet, something is there.
Okay, now if I ask Ranu madam, in economy, this is another tricky area where quite a range of questions are covered. And I think economy is the pillar of perhaps all discussions, be it development, be it conflicts, be it ethical issues, be it issues related to problems of, the present day trade wars. Everywhere I can see economy. So how does a student start economy? What will be the approach for economy and what books can they follow? Madam, if you can tell us something on that.
The first approach should be, they should always try to read economics in a macroeconomic perspective.
Excuse me, madam, can I interrupt for just 1 second? Can I ask the viewers on the YouTube, are you watching us? Is the streaming clear? Is the audio clear? Can you give us a confirmation? I need to ask because sometimes the buffering is a problem. Can the viewers tell us if the streaming is fine? Can you tell us if the streaming is fine? Ashok, Maurya, Anjali, Sneha, Lahiri. Can you tell us if the streaming is fine? Can you all hear us clearly? No problem, I believe. We are taking some of your doubts also in between. I can see your comments. Right. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Yes, madam. All is fine. They are excited listening to you. Yeah, please.
The approach should be...
Madam's audio may have a problem. If you can increase the volume, if you can. Or maybe keep the mic a bit close if you're using a mic. Otherwise, I think it's mostly clear for all. You can continue. Yes. Maybe speak a bit louder, ma'am, if you can.
Approach should be...
Please continue. Sorry for interrupting.
Approach should be macroeconomic. It should be aggregate. First thing. Secondly, the most important part are the social and economic problems which are having implication on masses in the long run. Those things are to be considered. And thirdly and most importantly is that economics is related to our day-to-day life since our childhood. We are reading this subject. Everything we are doing is related to economics. So we should have the practical understanding and then relate it to the part of the social problems which we are having in our country. And the books which we are reading in this is your NCERT, class 9, 10th, 11, 12th, Uma Kapila book is 21st edition book. And that book is very good. And it is having all the policies and programs which is going in the current scenario. Mishra and Puri is also good. So these are the three references along with economic survey, which we have to do. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Right, madam. Thank you so much. We have a question coming in here. What books can they read? Did you mention? I missed that, I think. Did you mention that, madam? What books can they refer to?
First is NCERT. Second is Uma Kapila Programs and Policies. And the third one is Mishra and Puri, along with Economic Survey and Budget.
What can they start with, madam? What can they start with? Some basic book that
ideally,
they can
they
build their concepts with?
NCERT. Sir, NCERT.
NCERTs is what madam is.
And with.
One of you was asking me that he is in college. So I think college time, if you are in the second or third year, that'll be very nice if you can look up NCERTs. And Gupta sir, I think NCERTs are also good for polity, right?
Yeah.
They can start from NCERTs for polity also, constitution and parliament?
That's correct. NCERT has to give the basic idea about many concepts like liberty, justice, the structure of the government. So,
right.
You know, minute concepts are given in NCERT. So, one should start from NCERT. It is recommended. So one should start from NCERT. And NCERT, if you are going to start from the 6th standard and up to it has to put the 11th, 12th, that would be very sufficient. That is the basic building for the, you know, making the preparation on polity and governance.
Right, sir. Now, I think another big area that students are concerned about, I think, are issues of environment. Environment and geography also, it has quite a bit of application. And every year there are questions related to ecosystems, global warming, ozone depletion, endangered species. So if I can ask Dimple madam, how exactly environment can be approached? We have some idea about economy, about issues of history and polity. Can you tell us something about environment? What books can they follow and what approach can they have for environment?
Sir, I would like to share my screen.
Yes, you can. You can speak now.
Yes,
I think if I may interject, One of our faculty here is probably having the YouTube also on. That's one reason why it is overlapping. Okay, if you can switch off the YouTube, then we can have only one voice. You want to share your screen? Okay, yes. Yeah, I've given the rights to share the screen. Please do.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sir, the basic approach for environment should be starting with NCRTs. What NCRTs are important? Three NCRTs are important, which is class 7th NCRT of that is the NCRT that is visible, our environment. One can have a basic understanding of environment from this basic NCRT. And thereafter, approaching higher class NCRTs, that is class 11 NCRT unit, not the entire NCRT has to be read, but certain units have to be read. For example, unit 14, that talks about the environment part, environment chemistry. And then class 12 NCRT, biology NCRT, that also not has to be read in entirety, but only unit 10 that contains chapter 13 to 16. I've attached the images so that the students do not get confused that which is the NCRT or not. So this is this image is of class 7, our environment. Then this is for class 11, chemistry NCRT, followed, and the chapter is also attached, the important chapters. And then it is biology NCRT. So these are the NCRTs that a student has to focus upon. This will help the student to build the important concepts, the important vocabulary. Thereafter, after this NCRT, some certain basic books can be referred. One basic book which is nice is by McGraw-Hill publication by Vaishali Anand ma'am. Other can be Environment and Ecology. This is one NCRT. This is one book that can also be referred. So the approach is basic concept building via NCRTs, then moving on to certain reference book, and thereafter. So one of the most important thing is having conceptual clarity. Lot many questions have come in previous UPSC questions which focus only on the basic concept. So one example can be the UPSC previous year question that is in 2013. This is the question which talked of basic concept, what is productivity, and then they asked an application based concept on this. This question was an application, but then this required a basic conceptual clarity from the student. So one approach is basic conceptual building via NCRT and understanding the application of the concept. Once this is done, another important area to focus for environment is the current affairs. For current affairs, two important aspects are focusing on the government initiatives, and then other aspect for environment for current affairs is you cannot actually have track down the current affairs on a daily basis. Almost everything and anything comes under environment. So reading magazines on fortnight basis or monthly basis, like Down to Earth, will help in moving from basic conceptual clarity to a better application. So there are three things: basic conceptual clarity via NCRTs, then current affairs via magazines, and focusing on the government initiatives and programs which are concerned related to environment.
So is there any right time when this study of environment should start? Because when we are scheduling the preparation, students tend to be slow in getting hang of current affair based reading. So would you recommend that they get into environment directly, probably initial, or should they wait for some time for the concepts to build up first?
Sir, current affairs for any topic should not be started from day one. The same concept which applies for answer writing also applies for newspaper reading and current affairs reading. Once a student has a basic idea of concepts, like what is, let's talk of inflation, what does inflation mean, what does productivity mean, then only they will have a proper understanding what is this current affair or this editorial trying to say. So having a conceptual clarity within 2 or 3 months after joining any, after starting any course, then they should move on to newspaper reading. Otherwise, if they start from the day one, they would not understand it better. Moreover, they tend to lose the interest fast. So at least have a clarity over the concepts and then start newspaper reading and current affairs reading.
Why we are discussing all of this, students, to all of you who are watching us on YouTube, This should give you a fair idea about what type of approach we will be having when we take up the courses. What type of focus we will be probably paying more attention to, and how we will be sequencing. Current affairs definitely is a very big concern for students when they are preparing. But our suggestion always is that when you start off, don't jump into too much of current affair based reading. Do some reading, take it more like a comprehension reading. But as your concepts start building up, when you know some words of polity, when you know some concepts of economy, when you know some concepts of environment, you know the terms, okay, then you can appreciate when you read the newspaper. I can see this is a very standard question. The moment we start the classes, the first question students ask us is which newspaper to read and how to read newspapers. There's no magic formula here. It's a slow, gradual process. But pay attention to the first couple of months when we are teaching the basics to you. And that's exactly what I think all the teachers are telling directly or indirectly. One more question to you, Dimple ma'am. I mean, this is a question, the favorite question students come up with is, how do you manage the list of endangered species and all the name of animals, birds, and you know, aquatic life of the Red Book? Would you recommend memorizing all of that down, or what approach would you say? Or simply leave because maybe one or two questions are asked from that. What is your approach about that?
If we talk about the investing time into reading so many species and then attempting one single question. One single question would comes in prelims, and investing so much of time in reading about the species, then, and that too, sir, in reference books also, the status changes in IUCN list, the red data list, the status change. So how do you keep track after every 1 month? Do you actually go and see what is the IUCN status for plus two marks? And even if you're marking it, you're not very sure what would be the answer key given based on the book or based on the IUCN status. So better would be to focus on other important areas like conventions, organization, rather than one single question on species. That is something I would recommend to the students.
Right. So don't mug up too many names of animals. If you are abreast with the current affair booklets and current affair based reading and newspapers, there are 10, 15, 20 life forms which are in news. And try to mark from that, but don't kill yourself trying to mug up all the animals which are endangered, critically endangered, which are going extinct. Okay, now we have that report that tells us the ravages of human intervention environment. I mean, we'll suddenly have no manageable format to memorize those name of animals. We are killing animals at an incredible pace. So don't kill yourself. You also will go endangered otherwise. Okay, that's some advice you all can take from us. Anyways, thank you so much, Dimple ma'am. That was a nice interaction we had with you. Now, Dipshika ma'am, if she can tell us how to manage the GS part of geography. I have been the optional teacher in geography for as many years I can remember. So, but GS, I think I will let madam speak because she has been teaching for quite some time now, almost 4 or 5 years. So if she can tell us, what is the step into geography? But that's also a very vast area in GS. Again, good application of geography is also in development, in rural aspects, irrigation, ethics, talk about forest environment. So ma'am, can you tell us something about that, please?
Yes, sir, you're right. Nowadays, GS has become more of applied. Not just GS, you know, every exam, every subject has become more applied in all the sense. So if you're reading a newspaper, the things that you should focus on is applied knowledge. Fine, so application of all the concepts that you will be getting from reading the NCERTs. So when we are dealing with geography, you should first start understanding that how geography is divided. So one is you have the physical part of geography, that is all the nature you have around you. All right. The other part is the human geography. And how we get to the applied part is how this human and environment interaction is happening. That is the applied part. So the questions that you are seeing in the mains nowadays is more on the applied part. Like, for example, they will talk about water conservation, water stress management. So all these questions are coming day in day out. For example, you have the questions on floods. right? So these are flooded areas, the coastal cities. So these are also the questions which are actually impacting the human life. So now the concept that you have to understand is first you read the physical part and then you read the human part. Human part will have all those things like agriculture, industries, their location, where they are located, the resources where they are found. So the first thing you should start is with NCERTs from 6 to 12. Okay, you will get an idea what I'm talking about, what you understand by physical, the part like the hydrosphere, the atmosphere, the biosphere, the cryosphere. Fine. So these are all the regions of the physical portion. The other portion is the human part. These are like agriculture, the industries, the resources. So from like sixth NCERT, it will tell you about the world part of the physical geography. And then you will move towards like eighth standard book that will talk about the resources. Fine. So this is the human part. So this is how you will understand NCERT also. You have to divide it. Okay, this is the human part and this is the physical geography part. Then you have to combine the two. That is, you will have to understand how this physical part impacts human and how human is impacting that natural part. So this also comes under environment also. What is happening in the environment and whatever you are studying in ecology, it is all dependent on human and environment interaction. So ultimately, whatever you are studying, you should bring it down to my interaction, that is human interaction with the natural environment. So every question that you read, you will understand, okay, this is based on that kind of interaction. Now I'm interacting with the environment in this way. I'm interacting with the soils. So that is how I'm talking about soil conservation and soil management. So you have to have the understanding, the conceptual clarity of what you are reading. Right. If you don't know what you are reading, if you have not mentioned the domains of your understanding, you will not be able to remember everything, because geography also have a lot of facts. So if you are finding like black cotton soil is present in the Deccan region. So why it is there? Because that is a Deccan lava plateau. So that is how you have to relate it in understanding. So black cotton soil, it will have cotton. So this is how you will understand the entire area when you will understand that how environment impacts human and human is impacting the environment. So it is there. It is in the industries also, where you have resources, you will have industries. Fine. So this is how I try to teach students, that start relating everything. If you correlate everything, you will understand each and everything. For example, if you're reading politics, fine. If you don't understand the boundaries of neighboring countries, you will never be able to understand the geopolitics of that region. Why we have conflicts with China? Right, because we share a boundary with that area. So geography in that term is everywhere. It is present everywhere. It is present in polity. It is present in economy. It is present in society. It is present in environment. It is present in ethics. Everywhere is there. Okay, so whatever you have, all the GS subjects that you have, if you have good knowledge of geography, you can actually write good answers on that. Sir, you are not audible, sir. Your mic.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, ma'am. This very interesting thing. Even when I used to prepare back, more than 20 years ago, and over the time I've seen, whenever we ask a teacher the importance of a portion in GS, we find every teacher says that is the most critical part of that GS. So you'll find a geography teacher saying geography is the most important part of GS. The economy teacher says is the most important part of GS. The history teacher will say that's the fundamental. The moral of the story is, in UPSC, you cannot leave any subject. Like, you cannot afford to ignore one or two areas and focus only on what you think is your strength. You have to spread your hand. The questions also are increasingly interdisciplinary. If you have a question in polity, you have to relate that to probably other aspects of development also. If you have a question in economy, you must link that to geography and a bit of history, our historical colonial, the past that we have had. If talking about good governance, you must bring in economic principles, you have to bring in ethical aspects, bring in a bit of constitution, bring in a bit of social issues also. I cannot see how any subject is any lesser than the other. So let's not have a debate on. I could see some questions. How important is, and can we leave some topics? So you cannot leave any topic when they are setting the type of questions they are setting. Okay, so fine. That's, thank you so much. Now, Ashwini sir, if you can tell us, society and social issues, I think, is one of the most neglected areas of GS preparation. Unfortunately, we take things like women issues or caste issues or problems of discrimination, problems of our culture, tradition. We tend to ignore it and take it for granted. So can you tell us what could be a good book to start with? What could be a good beginning in social issues and society so that we have a good command over, okay, in GS writing on these kind of topics?
The most important thing we need to understand, what is the perspective, why social issues and they are asking about. The reason is this: we need to understand UPSC is interested to know your understanding of Indian society in a realistic manner, point number one. And this topic is going to be more easy if you have the basic understanding about the Indian society and what are the issues related to the Indian society. And to have a good grasp over this concept, you can refer with the basic books like the 9th and 10th NCRT of Democratic Politics. You can refer 12th class Sociology NCRT books like Indian Society, Understanding Indian Society. Let me give you an example of what they are basically looking for. For example, everybody talks about, and it is mentioned in your UPSC syllabus also, social empowerment. So what should be our approach? How we are going to deal with social empowerment, so that if this particular topic comes in your UPSC examination, how you're going to deal with it? The point number one, you need to understand the meaning and concept of social empowerment. Point number two, do we need social empowerment in India? What is the need? What is the need of social empowerment in India? Then what are the specific sectors which require this intervention by the government? So therefore, you need to have an holistic understanding in addressing the questions coming from this particular topic, and it will give you an enhancement in your scoring in your GS paper one also. And it will also build a strong platform on which you can give, you can write a very good essay. And essay, as you know, it's very important.
I agree. Social issues, I'm sorry, I interrupted you in between. Social issues is a very good area to develop your essays from. Point is, you know, I'm also the essay teacher, emotional when somebody says or uses the word essay. So I could not resist interrupting here. Yes, Ashwini sir, I agree. A lot of topics can be written, at least some dimensions can be covered if the social issues discussions are good. Okay. Fine, one question to you while we wind up this first leg of the discussion. What do you think can be a good book to start with? Most of us have been recommending NCRT. So would you also recommend NCRT or some book that you think could be a good book?
I would say we should start with NCRT. Apart from NCRT, you can refer a book on Indian society written by Ram Ahuja. So this book you can start with. It is a good book. It will give you an understanding about Indian society. What are its features? What are the structures? And it will give you an holistic view about Indian society. You can start with this basic book here.
The Society by Ram Ahuja. And can you tell us which book is the NCRT book? Which class book is that?
9th and 10th Democratic Politics. It is related to Indian polity. And then
ninth
you can...
9th and 10th.
Okay. And then you can refer 12th class Indian Society, Sociology book. And 11th class Understanding Society, Social Development.
The 9th, 10th, 11th more or less is...
12th, yeah.
See, we are increasingly emphasizing this. All the teachers, you have heard, economy, Ms. Ranu speak, Madam Dipshika, Sunil Gupta sir talking about even history, Shivesh, all of us are insisting that NCRT is your fundamental pillar. Don't ignore it. There are questions that are asked from between the lines. The problem is, I mean, if I can relate to some of what I have seen in my students, the problem is NCRTs are taken too lightly. And most of them read NCRT for the sake of completing a chore. It's like a kaam hai, khatam karte hai, and just read through and finish it off. NCRTs are very well written books. In fact, they are one of the best books you can initiate discussions about anything. NCRT social issues, NCRT environment, NCRT geography, NCERT history and read it as many times as possible. As teachers, when we prepare our notes, even now we go back to NCERT. Those diagrams are so beautiful. Those sketches are so pertinent. I remember teaching my daughter those photographs of some sites and artifacts.
Yes.
Okay, the photographs of the temple layout in class 6th and 7th book are still very, very important. And I'm amazed that all the information is so beautifully there. Why are we ignoring those and getting into books of higher levels? Ultimately, you have to read the books of higher levels, but please do not ignore the books which are fundamental, that is NCERT books.
Sir, also they are coming from the government itself. So you are already preparing for the government exam. So you should understand those.
Yeah, in fact, some type of questions which have ambiguity,
you realize
that NCERT very specifically mentions something, and that's the best source.
Yeah.
And one thing more I want to add, sir. There is a proper way to read NCERT. Most of the students, they simply take a book and they read it like a novel. This is not the way. You need to open and decipher every line of NCERT to get the maximum benefit of that book, actually. For example, if you're reading an NCERT book and if they mention some word, immediately you need to know the meaning of that word. History or polity or geography, whatever, because NCERT books give you a very solid foundation.
Correct. Absolutely.
There was this question in the prelims that in the Harappan civilization, whether they had horses or not. The other standard books, they actually mention that they had horses. They have found that in Surkotada. Fine. But in the NCERTs, it is written, it is doubtful. Okay. The question in the UPSC was, are you certain or not? But most of the people, they marked certain. But the NCERT said it is doubtful. So that is how you have to understand that the UPSC will go by the NCERT. So the answer key was based on that it is doubtful. So you have to read the NCERTs, not just NCERTs, but NCERTs are the minimum requirement for this examination.
Shivesh sir is smiling because...
No, this is correct. Say is very right, sir.
Yes. But Shivesh sir, would you recommend reading the medieval history book of NCERT also? Because back then we could afford to skip it, but would you recommend that students read at least these three books, NCERT, Ancient India, Medieval India, and the Modern India? Would you recommend
that? NCERT always, as usual, our all panelists are unanimous on this point, that this should be started with as a ritual. And what Ashwini Shankar sir rightly said, that in between the lines, many times you will come across with. And the wordings, that is very important. Normally, students skip that word. They don't understand the meaning and they're up to date, directly switch over to higher books. That is bad practices. So NCERT, we must go for.
One of the intentions why we are having this webinar and telling you maybe most of what we say you already know, but maybe hearing from the horse's mouth, you probably are more certain. But one reason why we have this webinar is you get to know the team which is part of the GS in EduChemy. This is the core team. We will have more teachers also coming on with us to take up some other areas also. But I think these 4 or 5 areas are the core areas. Okay, so please do participate and ask us your doubts. We have one question, Dimple ma'am, for you. What do you think? Should students study NCERTs for science also?
Sir, from class 6 to class 10th, all the NCERTs should be read, and the science from that NCERT should also be read. The kind of questions which are actually coming in prelims, if we do not have a basic understanding of what is biotechnology, then how do we apply the knowledge and what application would be of biotechnology? So yes, up to 6 to 10th, even science NCERTs have to be read. And for particularly 11th, 12th, for example, for environment, I mentioned that which units have to be covered. That way they can also, even there's a unit of biotechnology in class 12th NCERT. So that should also be covered. So we cannot afford to miss NCERTs even for science.
So all those who bunked your classes in school and went to watch movies, who bunked your classes and went on to do something else, you know, karma gets back to you. Okay. And when you decide to start off your UPSC preparation, okay, you have to get back to your school life again. 6th to 10th, there has to be no compromise at all. 6th to 10th, line by line, word by word, and these are school books, should not take you much time if you do it sincerely. And then probably select areas of class 11th and 12th. I will not recommend you read all the books of 11, 12. You don't have to read physics and chemistry and biology and botany. Okay, you don't have to do that. But the basic areas of fundamental economics, fundamental society, fundamental history, the basics of geography, I think NCERT is important. We'll tell you more on this when you take admission and join us for EduChemy courses. Okay. So, by the way, one question that we have, I mean, we did discuss, but maybe we need to stress on, is how do we make notes? How do we make our jottings and notes? I will take this question on behalf of all of us. We already have told this to you, and Shivesh has said this to you. You have got three type of notes that you must work with. One is your running notes. Running notes are those notes which are part of your class discussions, assuming you're part of some type of coaching or the other. Otherwise, the second type of note is the note and the jottings that you make while you are reading a book. When you read a book, you cannot summarize the book line by line. Pick up the important word, pick up the important sentence, pick up the important phrase, and jot that down like a quick reference. And the jotting has to be as thorough as possible so that all the important points of that book are in your pages. I tell the students, one of the key ways to measure that is, can you dispose of your book or not? Can you totally ignore the book and rely on your notes or not? If you can do that, then your notes and jottings is complete. But does not mean you copy down every word. Pick up the keywords. And a third type of jotting, of course, will be the summarizations you make of the class note if you're part of some coaching. Answer writing comes a bit differently. So notes to banana bahut zaruri hai for three reasons. If you make notes, you'll have a discipline in writing. If you make notes, you will learn the method of summarizing. And if you make notes, you will learn how to revise also when you have crunch of time and your examinations are nearer. Before the examination, it is impossible to read the books in thorough detail. Notes is what will help you to keep track of whatever you have been reading till now, or by the time you give examination. So that's more or less, we have touched on all the important areas. Now, one question probably I can ask Ashwini sir. Ashwini sir, what do you think? How much time should be given to newspapers in a day?
The most important thing, I would advise that the moment you join your GS preparation, you should not jump to the newspaper reading. You need to have a certain basic understandings about polity, about economics, about your sciences. After that, if you're doing the newspaper in a proper way, it will not take you more than 1 hour, 30 minutes in doing all the and going through all the important facts. Because the newspaper is a newspaper for other person, but for you, it's your textbook. When you are reading a textbook, here I'm also touching one of the points, how to read a book also. You see, you have to look, what is happening the moment the student used to see the Hindu or Indian Express, they have a tendency, they want to read each and everything. So that is not required. You are not supposed to read the entire center page of the newspaper. You have to select the most important and specific news, which is related to the subtopics or the topic given in your syllabus. Therefore, the very first important thing which you need to mug up, that your syllabus should be on your tips. That is the first thing that you're supposed to do. You should know the syllabus of UPSC like a back of your hand. The moment if some topic is coming in the newspaper, immediately it will reflect in your mind, this particular news is related to this particular topic. And if you're going by this point of view, it will not take them more than 1 hour, 30 minutes in
reading a newspaper. So basically what we're stressing on is your newspaper reading makes sense only when your concepts are in place. Aapko thoda samajh mein aa raha hai polity, you understand a bit of history, understand a bit of economy, you appreciate geography, you have an understanding of environment. When you have some amount of understanding, then your reading of newspaper will make sense. Otherwise, newspaper, once you give up on the paper because you can't understand, then for the entire duration of the preparation, current affair will be a burden for you. Current affair should not be a burden. It is perhaps the most important way how you can groom yourself for the examination.
Sir, Sir, I would like to add something here. So whenever the students are reading the newspaper, for example, there is an article about the Persian Gulf. Okay, so they are talking about the Persian Gulf. So you are also reading geography. So it will not take much time if you just Google where the Persian Gulf is actually located and see the countries that open up to Persian Gulf. So that is how you can actually strengthen your map reading also along with newspaper only. So all the places that you have, you know, new places you have read, Gulf of Oman is there, Persian Gulf is there. Fine, there is some country that you have just, Yemen. You should know where is Yemen. So if there is something in the news, go and look up on the Google and see the Google Maps, it is there. Okay, at least do that because it will be, because you need to have a context. When you are reading the maps, you cannot remember every country. But if you remember it through any information given in the newspaper, okay, this was the topic on Persian Gulf and this is where the Persian Gulf is located. You have a context, you have a story about Persian Gulf. Okay, this was happening in the Persian Gulf and that is why I checked it up on the map. This is how the student will always remember where certain country is located. Otherwise, the map reading will also be difficult if you just go and try to see all the countries on the map.
I'll take up a question. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Yes. I'll take up a question from Ramya Lakshmi. Ramya Lakshmi is asking, does the daily news and editorial summaries released by institutes substitute newspaper reading or not? Now, look, guys, what is the purpose of reading newspaper? The purpose of reading newspaper, or what the purpose why UPSC asks you question from current affairs? The purpose essentially is not simply to know facts. The purpose is, are you able to think, analyze? Are you able to relate? Do you have an opinion on some things or not? So what happens is newspaper reading gives you maximum benefit if you're able to think on the issues and develop your own ideas about how the conversation on that particular issue is taking shape. The narrative around issues is very, very important. What happens is, when you rely on the processed material of institutes, I repeat this for all of you, this is perhaps one of the most important reasons why students are challenged. When you rely on the processed material of institutes on current affairs, you stop thinking about issues entirely. The institutes give you bullet form, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 points. You mug up and go. And when the questions are slightly twisted, when the questions ask you something on conceptual aspect, you are found wanting. So I will not say don't read the processed material, but processed material is only a type of a revision source for you. Okay. The processed material is only a type so that you can consolidate the work for you. But the actual reading always happens from the key books. It's something like watching a movie and reading the review of the movie. Okay, review of the movie is a very good summary. It's a very good idea somebody has given you. This is what the movie is about. But until you yourself have watched the movie, until you yourself has seen and thought about the movie, you'll never appreciate what the movie was actually. It's something like, you know, you are removing all the soul of an article and you are only focusing on the facts. And that makes current affairs reading boring also. That makes current affair revision a burdensome exercise. So do read summaries, but at a later stage when you're consolidating. Do read summaries at a later stage when you want to revise maybe. So your institute's material cannot be a substitute. It can be a supporting document for you. It can be a document which helps you, okay, remember things better when you can't jot down everything. But don't think the institute's material and the booklets can ever be a substitute. You find a lot of material in the market which are summaries of NCERT books also, which are summaries of important textbooks also. There are summaries of reports also. But the understanding you will have by reading the actual NCERT, the understanding you will have reading the actual book is far, far more than what you'll have when you read these kind of summaries. In fact, some of you are asking us, what is the method that we will follow in Edukemi? Now, I am a firm believer of you cannot replace textbooks in your study. You cannot replace the key references in your revision and your study pattern. That is why all of us here, okay, deliberately, when we take the classes for you, we will ensure you open up your books. We will teach for 1 hour, half an hour, 45 minutes, and we'll make you open the reference books. We'll make you open the NCRTs. We'll make you open some of the important reference documents or reports. And we will tell you, you must underline, you have to look into your books also. So this is one strategy. Now, the second aspect of strategy will follow. Some of you are asking us, how will we go about teaching GS in Edukemi? Now, see, this is rather immodest to say that we will be the best. That's our effort, definitely. But we are trying to evolve ourselves in a different way. Okay, and if you understand that, you will appreciate that. We are starting the courses from October the 20th. And we have to get ready for 2021. As of now, many of you have not joined classes because of the COVID scare. You were not very sure, online, offline, whatever. But I think now the writing is on the wall. Now it's very, very clear that online will be something for some more time. Offline probably will be postponed for a couple of more months, if not 1 year. So you have to start preparation. And starting from October until the examination, we need approximately about 8 months to cover. And that's exactly the time that we have. All our courses will be in the evening. I repeat, our courses will be in the evening. The classes will start at around 5, 5:15. And we will have, okay, 3.5, 4, 4.5 hours of classes. Essentially, we will be covering two classes every day with a gap in between. Otherwise, you cannot finish the syllabus and get ready for the examination. So it will be an intense exercise. Your evenings will be booked with us. Okay, we will try to do whatever justice we can. We have tried to put together, I think, a very commendable team, some of the well-known teachers, a mix of experience and young, and a mix of, you know, all the subjects have come together. So you can be sure about our efforts, and we will grow as we grow along, okay, or we work together. So we will pay importance to your books. We will pay importance to your basic readings. We will ensure that you will have your notes taken. And one of the supports we will have, will give you, is a lot of personal attention, where you can ask us our doubts. You can ask us your queries also. In fact, one of the major concerns students have is the debate between online and offline, which is a better one. Okay. And I think I will let probably Gupta sir answer this. Sir, aapka kya isme take hai? Honestly, I do not have much to choose from. But if we are to choose, what do you think? Which is a better medium?
Well, sir, I found offline is more appropriate than online. Particularly after a lockdown period, I have seen. Because this has to save the time of the students. And many students have problem adjustment in Delhi also. So at least, you know, such kind of adjustment is not going to be happen. They have to, you know, have to come from the rural background. And there are some, you know, what I feel, they have to face many problems related to family issues, related to, you know, rent issues. So I think, you know, this is the very, very important way and important means. So I do understand that if they are getting enriched information from the home, there is no need to just, you know, go for the offline. Yes, offline, it's okay. But I, what I felt, you know, so far, because I have also associated many institutions, many digital platforms, I have seen there is no differentiation between the offline and online. Even online has become the more better than, you know, offline mode. But I feel so.
If I am answering the same question, just to add, now there's two things, you know, offline, online is actually to some extent a bad debate. These are two mediums. Both of them have the pros and cons. The advantage of offline is a physical presence. You can see a person in flesh, blood, and he is in front of you. You have a classroom setting. You sit down and study. That's what we have been used to do. Okay, it's a brilliant medium. I'm not saying offline will go away. online has its own advantage and disadvantages. Mm-hmm. One very big disadvantage of online is the physical presence is missing. Yeah. But, you know, I think we have come a long way now to be bogged down by these kind of issues. If you want to join offline, if you think that's the best one for you, please go ahead and join offline. Wait for the lockdown, get over and do join. Okay, we are not promoting the idea, leave offline.
Yeah.
But if you want to start off and not waste time, if you want to have the convenience of staying in your convenient place and study, it could be home or wherever you want, then go for online. In fact, it's a very nice time when you have both the mediums working together. Okay, I do not know how offline will shape up, but ye bhi fact hai, offline, you have to come to Delhi. You must go to your capital city, wherever you are. You must live in hostels. The fooding could be an issue if you do not know that area well. Online problem could be issues of technology, buffering. Some people say you can't afford a laptop. I do not know if you can't afford a laptop. Trust me, guys, you can't even afford living in Delhi. Okay, or you can't even afford living in Hyderabad or Bangalore. So it's a fraction of a cost. Invest in a good machine, invest in a good connectivity, and that's about it. But yes, if you desperately want that you have to be in presence of flesh and blood of a teacher, that's your call. Go ahead for offline. There's no promotion here for online. But all the others who do not want to waste your time or start off, particularly those who are in colleges, those of you who are working, those of you who can't give full time, okay, to come to a city and prepare, online is the best. And the technology is changing very fast. Now, increasingly, we find the connectivity, the technology, the way of methods, the teaching, they're all changing, evolving very fast. Okay, you know, I remember it was 4 or 5 years ago, I was debating with somebody about online market, Amazon, and I kind of rejected it. How can somebody buy clothes and shoes without touching the fabric in the mall? How can somebody buy, okay, food without seeing the food physically? And this was story of 4 or 5 years ago. Aaj ke date mein, everything has gone online. People can buy shoes. I can't even imagine how can people buy shoes online. You do not know how the shoe fits you, but that's doing pretty well. So I think it's a matter of time when things will change, evolve, and it's all entirely up to what you think is you are prepared to take up as a part of a change. So that's don't get into this debate of online acha hai, offline acha hai. It's entirely your call. Okay, there was a time, okay, when we had only horses, we could not have thought of any other medium. There was a time when students study in Gurukul in the jungles with the yogis and muni and rishis. Okay, things have changed. So I think it's a part of tradition. It's just that we are in a flux state. So get off this debate and focus on what is available to you and what works best for you. This is my suggestion to all of you. I think more or less we have covered most of the topics that we had decided. Can I request any one of you, or maybe Ranu madam, if you think we need to tell them something more, we might have missed something, maybe something related to how can they manage the pressure. If you have some words, you can always tell them, please.
You all need to be consistent in your effort. Just follow what we are giving you in the class. Follow us for next 3 to 4 months. Then you'll be able to appreciate that what all you have read, you have understood the basic concepts, you have understood the NCRT, how to read NCRT, and you will be able to understand then further reference books also after doing NCRTs and taking class notes seriously.
Right, right. Thank you so much. I think more or less you have summed up whatever we have said. The classes are beginning from October the 20th. The admissions are on. You're all welcome to come and try us. We do have discounts also. We also offer support to girl students and those who come from weaker economic backgrounds. That's probably taken for granted because you do need support. We're ready to support you there. This is the team plus another 3-4 of us. Feel free to get in touch with us. I would not like to extend the discussions anymore. If we are done more or less, any messages, any one of you would like to tell the students, you are welcome to say so, please. Yeah, Ashwini sir has a few words. Please listen to him.
The most important thing which I want to say to all the students who are watching this webinar, that you should enjoy the process of learning. You are upgrading your mental status every day, like you are upgrading your status on WhatsApp. Yeah. Here, you are upgrading your mental status. And the most important thing, the more passion you have in your studies, you are going to have amazing results. Therefore, you need to have passion for your dream, and you are lucky enough at the right platform. Work hard and convert your dream into a reality.
Thank you so much, Ashwini sir. And he's right. This is a tough examination. Let us not trivialize that. This is a tough examination. You have got 12, 13 lakh students aspiring. We have got people as much as 5, 6 lakh of them actually give the examination. The vacancies are lesser in the actual civil services. But if you look at the affiliate jobs, you talk about RBI, you talk about IES, you talk about Forest Services, you can talk about NABARD, you have got state services, the lot of other examinations which are linked to this preparation. And in your 20s, when you are still young, I think it's worthy that you also invest a couple of years in a bigger dream. Okay, so do not take it as a burden. Enjoy the process, he's right. Learn more about the country and the world, not simply the small area that you had focused on in terms of what you prepared for graduation. And all of us know how graduation is done. So forget about education there. We have learned wrong things about how to beat the system there. So this will be a very nice exercise where we all participate in a different type of an education. So feel free to come up and be part of the courses. All the courses will be the evening. And we are going to teach you in English medium. We do not have regional language classes as of now. It's all in English medium. Okay, and I hope you all benefit in this program. So thank you so much. My personal gratitude to all of you, the panelists, Ranu Madam, Shivesh Sir, Sunil Gupta Sir, Dimple Ma'am, Dipshika Madam, and Ashwini Sir. Thank you so much for being a part of this platform. And thank all of you, dear students, for watching us for almost 1.5 hours. That's not a short time, though some of you have gone and come back again. Okay, but I hope we have tried answering some of your questions. In any case, this webinar was not to clarify all your doubts. This webinar was primarily to get to meet our team. In fact, that's what I wrote on my board also, meet our team. And that gives people some confidence as to who we are, what we are trying for, what we are trying to get across. So, you have seen all of us. So you can have a sense of confidence that we are not running away with what we are promising. And these are some of the very well-known teachers we have. So be part of our team. Be part of the process. It'll be a pleasure to support you through your dreams for Indian IAS. Thank you so much. The timing will be in the evenings. We're also launching a couple of other courses. We'll let you know about that. Okay. For GS 2021, the classes start in the evening and go on for approximately 4.5 hours, depending on the coverage. There'll be intensive classes and we tend to cover most of the syllabus. So thank you so much, sir. Okay, my regards to all and good wishes, dear students. Thank you for joining.